guys. In this video I'm going to do some work on this Toshiba laptop. It's an older laptop, as you can see it's pretty thick, but hopefully it still works well. Let me show you its specs if I can. It has an unreadable Windows license. Let me just show that to you. You cannot see anything on that license. So if you have one of these stuck to your laptop, put some transparent scotch tape over it so you do not have this problem over time. Of course, this takes years of use, but it can happen. It's a dual core at 2.1 GHz. It has DDR2, total of 2 GB. No hard drive at the moment. It's a standard 2.5 inch SATA drive. It has a DVD writer. And it's missing the F8 key and the mouse nipple in the middle of the keyboard is actually also missing, as you can see there. So hopefully I can fix this thing. I'm unable to tell you the exact model because, as you can see, also this sticker is completely gone, and searching for the informations here, I'm getting more than one model. So, I don't know, it could be an M305 or an L305. All I know for sure, it's a Toshiba, and it has Tecra written onto it. So, yeah, that's about all I know for sure. So, let's get to doing stuff to this laptop. Okay, so first thing, I looked at the underside of the laptop. This is for the memory, this is where I need to put the hard drive, and what is this? I never saw something like this. It doesn't have a screw. You just need to push in this hole here. Actually, let me find a good position for that. And let me try and show you a little bit better, probably like this. Push here and pull on it. Actually, it lifts up and behold what we have here. This is the coolest thing I have ever seen in a laptop. Here we actually have the space between the heatsink fins and the fan itself. So for example, look, of course this thing shouldn't be here. This is it's from another wire in the laptop. This is a conductor to make contact between two metal parts or a metal part and the inside of the case, something like that. So this shouldn't be here. But this usually is, because in most laptops, the place where dust collects is between the actual fan and the heatsink fins, because the heatsink fins act as somewhat of a filter. So you can actually clean the cooler in this laptop, the cooling part, extremely simple. You undo that and you pull out the dust, and this thing is basically clean. That's about it. So how awesome is this thing? I wish all laptops have something like this, but sadly they don't. So now let's put this thing back. Not really sure how it goes in. It will most likely slide in a way or other. Yeah, and it's in. But that honestly is pretty awesome. I wasn't expecting to see something like that on a laptop, but yeah, sadly it didn't catch on and it's not used. I didn't see it on any laptop until now. Okay, it doesn't have the screw. Actually, there are tons of missing screws in this thing. You can see here, most of them are missing. So I'm going to search through my pile of random screws and see what I can find. Of course, this thing will go in. What's the correct way? This is the correct way, it seems. And I'm thinking, actually, not really sure, will this thing hold it down good enough? Yes, it will. It actually has rubber here and it has rubber here in the corner, so it will actually hold the hard drive down without the need for screws. I was thinking of putting some double-sided tape or something on it, but there is no need. Of course, as you can see, this thing is really hard to put in and it has a cable and this thing is not fixed to anything. So yeah, it seems on this laptop you have good things and you have bad things, and this for me is one of the bad things, because these thin cables are easily damaged and I am unable to insert the hard drive into this thing. Doesn't want to go in at all. Why doesn't it want to go in? That is pretty weird. Okay, in the end it went in. Let's put it in its correct position. That's about it. As you can see, it's pretty high, so obviously these things will hold it down without an issue. So hard drive in. I don't know if I told you it's a 160 gigabyte hard drive. And as this thing moves, I'm sure that it doesn't make contact with the drive. So I will put double-sided tape on these four corners to make sure that it will hold it down. So let's search for that in a moment. Double-sided tape cut and put into position. Do not use your strongest tape. There is no need for that. Actually, it's even bad, because when you are taking this thing off, you might actually pull the cable out. So just some weak double-sided tape. As you can see, this is sticking, but almost at all. So, and not a lot of it again. So let's put this thing back in now. And yeah, no more moving. Now again, I need to find some screws. So let's do that. Annoyingly, I am unable to find the correct screws and enough of them. As you can see, this is an original screw. It's extremely long. All that I was able to find a bit similar is these two screws, but they are a bit shorter. Hopefully enough. I have tons of these ones, but they are so short they do not reach the thread. I have these, which are almost as long as these two, but they are thinner. And these, which are even shorter, I have lots of them, but yeah. So this is annoying. It has really, really long screws. What I'm going to try and see, if I can remove the original ones and find a hole where even one of these could reach, so then I use an original longer one in a hole where this cannot reach. For this, for the hard drive, probably any of these is good enough, no problem there, but lots of them are missing, so yeah, I will see what I can do. So I'll be back in a moment. It's finally done. I searched a hell of a lot for all these screws, but as you can see, hopefully every single hole has a screw in it, although the heads of the screws don't really match. That's all I could find, and it was really, really difficult. And for example, I tried, I had a bunch of these, I thought they are long enough and the good thread size, but they were wrong and they were actually short. And this one actually got stuck in one of the holes, so I couldn't get it out, so I had to super glue this thing to the screw. So let's break it now. That's about it. So yeah, it's done. Next thing, maybe you can see here, one of its feet is actually missing, so I have another feet from another foot, sorry, from another laptop. It's a bit narrower and a bit longer. So yeah, I need to cut it. Let me just mark where I need to cut it. Okay, it's marked. Hopefully it's marked well. Of course I drop it, why not? And yeah, should be good. Glue it in place. After you put the laptop on it, it will glue even better in time. This thing I will keep. Eventually, probably, I will put even this on a laptop somewhere. And yeah, at this point, let's turn it around and see what we have here. Okay, for this thing, maybe you saw in my other videos, on Dells and on Lenovo's, almost every time this thing is missing. So I cut this. You can see I can remove them, but I'm not going to remove them. I just removed one. I have it here. I'm going to make a tiny square hole in the middle, but not through the other side. I will put just a bit of super glue in that hole and then push it in here. And that's it. It's done. I've used this fixed a few times. It works perfectly. And obviously I will make this black with a marker. So be back in a moment. Looks way better. Obviously, when doing this, make sure your keys do not touch it, because if they touch it, your pointer will be always moving on the screen. Mine do not and never did. Now for the 8th key, I have this Fujitsu Siemens that is has a few stuck keys. It's not working anymore, so I'm going to take away the 8th key. Obviously it's not the same keyboard, but I think I can make it work somehow. Okay guys, this is the key. Sadly it doesn't fit, although the chances of it fitting directly were slim to non-existent. But as you can see, if I leave it just on top of the rubber, it's perfectly at the same level, and the overall size is good enough that it doesn't stand out as being from something else. Obviously I will put a marker on top of the blue luminosity symbol, and obviously I need to remove these attachments because they do not fit. So we need it to be able to go as low as possible and not hit on the plastic from the original key, because I will not remove this plastic. This plastic is good, and if the next owner of this laptop ever wants to buy the original key from somewhere, you just take this thing off, because I will glue it, but just a little bit of glue. So you can remove it if you insist and if you really want, but it will still stay in place. So this will not be removed. This key will have all the modifications on it. So let me rip that off. If you're wondering how I remove pieces of plastic, it's with this thing. And it's kind of easy, just grab onto it and start turning to the side. Obviously on this side it's harder, this was a bit further from the edge, but here it's a bit closer to the edge, so it's not going to be that easy. Although you probably cannot see anything because this thing is out of focus and it wasn't even centered on the camera, so sorry about that. You just need to take your time and do not break the key itself. You need to break only these little attachments. Okay, as you can see, those are perfect. Let's get to the next ones. When you are able to grab onto it better, it's way easier. and it's perfect. Now just a tiny bit of super glue and this key will be perfect. As you can see, the key is in, blacked out that blue symbols. The permanent marker is still drying. In the end it will not be that visible as it is now, but yeah, in my opinion it looks pretty decent. Okay, next thing, for the charger, I got the charger together with the laptop. I discussed a little bit with the guys selling it. They don't normally give chargers with laptops, but for me they make exceptions. As you can see, it's not quite perfect in this area here, so I will try and put some heat shrink on that thing just to protect it a little bit, maybe even at this end. As you can see, it's also not quite perfect. And found a cable for it. As you can see, it has only two pins, standard cassette player cable. And yeah, next thing, I'll try and power it up, if I could actually find where to plug the charger. Okay, let's plug in the cable. You can see here the light, so it's charging. Actually, this is that it's plugged in, and this is for the battery. So I don't really know, I might just let it charge, or no, let's try and power it on and see what we get. It does power on. Yeah, it has low BIOS battery, so I might need to change that, probably. So let's enter the BIOS. Oh, this is an old BIOS. I haven't seen these colors in a while. Let me just move you a little bit. Okay, memory, 2 gigs of RAM. I don't see the hard drive. Just, okay, no, this is for password. Anyway, I'm going to try and put Windows 10 32-bit on this thing. Hopefully it runs well. And yeah, next, protect this cable a little bit and try and change the BIOS battery. Let me see where that little thing is. Let me try and see how I can go to the next page. As this thing seems to have 2 pages, but I have no clue how I can get to that one. Tab maybe. Nope. Okay. Have no clue. So be back in a moment. Yeah, it actually writes here what you need to do. So page up first, page down second. But I still can't see the size of the hard drive. But I'm ready to bet that it's been detected properly. So no problems about that. If you ever need to put heat shrink on a wire that has connector at the end, and the heat shrink that you want to use shouldn't be too big, for example, I don't know, this one will go through the connector, but it will never tighten enough for this cable, and as it is, the one that I choose will not go through the connector. You can make it a bit larger for a while. You put it on something like this, stretches as much as you can, and then heat it up on both sides and stretch it even more. It will not tear, it will not get damaged if you don't overheat it, obviously, and it goes in its place. And then when it's at the end, you simply heat it up and it will shrink to its minimum size, obviously. So yeah, that's about it. I will heat it up now. Ready to start installing Windows 10. As you may see here, this is finished. The cable doesn't bend in that area to create problems anymore. The same with the plug that's already in the laptop. So yeah, Windows 10, 32-bit, because we only have 2 GB of memory, and 64-bit will struggle on 2 GB of memory. And we are booting from a USB drive, of course. And one thing that I noticed, either the BIOS battery isn't actually completely discharged, or it's a rechargeable battery, or when you actually have even a tiny bit of charge in the laptop main battery, it will not give that error anymore. Even if you unplug it, you shut it down, do whatever, it will not give the low battery error anymore. So I'm not going to open this thing just to see what's there. It doesn't give the error, good enough for me. If it will create problems in the future, we will deal with them at that point in time. So now let's install Windows on this thing and see how that goes. Up until now, exactly what I was telling you that it shouldn't do. Or, okay, this is a problem. It's not even because of the little thing that I put there. So that might be actually damaged internally, because it doesn't actually move. So it's not working. What the hell? That was it. So this is not working at all, but it still went up and... yeah, weird. Let's continue to install Windows. If you don't have a key for Windows 10, you can use it as a trial forever. It will not force you to reinstall it or buy a key. And again, this thing is moving. Hopefully when the drivers are installed, it will not do this, because the touchpad is not responsive when it's doing this thing, and it's not from the button in the middle, the nipple. So it seems to have a mind of its own. I'm going to install home version, because this laptop will never use the features from pro version. It's not needed. Next. And see how it goes. Hopefully when I install the driver for the touchpad, it will actually work correctly. But yeah, not quite happy about this. Again, when it stops moving by itself, it's working well, but who the hell knows. So yeah, I'm going to create some partitions and continue. And we are running Windows 10. As you can see, all drivers installed. This is really strange for an old laptop like this. Windows 10 installed all drivers. I don't think this ever happened to any of the laptops that I worked on. It's awesome. What can I say? Nothing for me to do regarding the drivers. As you can see, Windows is not activated. It's a trial, obviously. 32-bit, 2 gigs of RAM, CPU, everything seems to be running perfectly. Let me try and see if you have weird activity around here. Nothing. So this thing actually works incredibly well. Well, that's unexpected. Let's install some programs. Some updates on this thing. Not everything is perfect. One thing that it's good is the battery, or at least half good. You can see it's estimating half an hour, but that with lots of hard drive activity. Windows started to do its usual updates. So yeah, I don't know, maybe half an hour to an hour real life out of this battery. That's about that. I couldn't really fix the touchpad problem. I don't know, I think it's actually defective. So the best idea for the moment was to uninstall it from device manager, so it will not bother me. And it seems that it actually uninstalls at the same time even the tiny pointer, so they are connected somehow. I have no clue, but yeah, It works with an external mouse without any issues. I do not know, weirdly I uninstalled it. I do not have the option to disable it like on this thing, on the this is my wireless mouse. I uninstalled it and it basically disappeared. Even if I scan for hardware changes, restart my computer, it doesn't come back. So for now that is perfect. I don't know, let me just do one last thing. But I really do wonder where it is. In the system, I think. Yeah, system. Advanced system settings and in hardware. Yeah, hardware and device installation settings. If this is set to yes, it will download the apps, drivers and other weird stuff by itself when it finds something online. If you set it to no, it will not do that by itself. So you have to install any drivers if it doesn't have them. If Windows already has those drivers, it will install them by itself. If it doesn't have them, it will not install them, it will not search online for them. Okay, so we are set about that. Hopefully you cannot reinstall the driver for the touchpad. Actually, it's a really small and annoying touchpad, so yeah. I'm not happy that it doesn't work, but it's almost useless, so I'm not even bothered. And you might be wondering why this thing is opened and why the R key is missing. Well, it didn't work. You would press on it, nothing would happen. So in a situation like this, obviously first thing, open it up. Let me try and not make a short here, Open it up and try and reseat the keyboard cable. I also reseated the touchpad cable, just in case. Okay, after you reseat that, it does exactly the same thing, so it's not the cable. In a keyboard like this, mechanically, there's about nothing that can go wrong. So it's a contact somewhere. Traces, they can be broken because this thing is pretty small and pretty protected. So yeah, no corrosion anywhere. So at that point, the only thing that remains, you have the copper interlacing connections and you have the I don't know, it looks like rubber, but it has some carbon in it to make contact between the copper connections. Somewhere around there, either you have a short between this and it always registers as key pressed and it decides to ignore it, so it doesn't stop the computer from working, or it actually has a layer of I don't know, not corrosion, some oxide, some dirt, something that it prevents them from making contact when you press the carbon thingy. From lack of a real name, I have no idea how it's called. So at this point you take away the key and you are able to wiggle this thing around. So you are cleaning with that carbon, you are cleaning the traces. And at this point, as you can see on the screen hopefully, this thing starts to work. But you do not stop here, you wiggle it like mad, do not break it, but wiggle it, make sure you actually clean that area, because once you have the key on, you cannot wiggle it anymore. You just press it down. Now, to be sure that it will actually work when you put back the keyboard, because maybe now you can press a bit more than you are pressing when you have your key on. Take the key and put it backwards, with its face down, and press with it. If it works, you can see it working up. Okay. If it works, it means that it will actually work when you turn it the right way around. So yeah, that's about it. Actually, it will not work for the moment, but there's another reason why it's not working for the moment. It's because of this, it cannot get low enough. So when you will turn it around and clip it in place, it will work again. So yeah. If by any chance it still doesn't work when you turn it around, put a spacer between it and the rubber part. and then it will work for sure. But in my case, I'm 99% sure it will work without a spacer, because the first time I opened it and I pushed with my finger normally, it didn't actually work until I started to wiggle. So should work. Okay, that's about that for the moment. Let me put back the keyboard and continue from there. Before closing everything back up, you may have noticed that this key was actually moving. This one is okay. This one has its plastic guides, I don't know exactly how to call them, broken. So it's wiggling around it in its place. It's still working, but quite annoying. So what I'm going to do, use the same double-sided tape that I used for the battery, and if I don't drop it directly on the... Okay, this is a bit annoying to do. Let me try and use something a bit smaller. I think this is too big. Yeah, too big. Needs to be a bit thinner. I'm going to put this double-sided tape here, and it will actually keep it in its correct position, and it will not prevent it from going down, because this is like a sponge. But it will make sure it doesn't wobble and wiggle around. Okay, let's put one in the other side. Need to make sure they are not visible, and they are not. Peel this off, the protection. I usually don't film everything when I do stuff like this, because it's really time consuming and the video will be really, really, really long. Okay. Now, the next thing that I need to do is force this button in its position, because I took it out by using this. So that's not going to be really funny, and most likely I will do it off video. I'm going to try and put one corner in, but it will stick to the double-sided tape, obviously, because that is what it wants to do, which is pretty much a good thing, but not at this very moment. Okay, everything seems fine. Let's put this corner in. I'm obviously trying not to break it, that would be really bad. I know it's not going to be used probably, but that doesn't mean it has to be aesthetically not pleasing or ugly or whatever. Okay. Yeah. We don't really have the click anymore. So that is a bit annoying. Hopefully it doesn't stay clicked always. It actually might. It's always clicked. That is even worse. So I need to open it up and double the layer of double-sided tape to make it stay higher. When you press on it, it has where to go, because now it's clicked all the time. So back to the drawing board. Knowing that the R key had a problem, I decided to test them all, and behold, I found that this one actually was not working. And I decided to try and do something without opening it up. So I just pushed, let me go to the end of the text. Hopefully you can see text and key. Thunder. And I pushed on it something like this. Not smashing to destroy it, but pushing rather strongly on it. And a lot of times. And as you can maybe see, this thing started working by itself. So it actually cleared the layer that didn't allow it to make contact. And this probably happened because this thing wasn't used for a really long time. If it's always used, this shouldn't happen. Unless you spill something on it, in which case you probably kill it yourself. So let's give it a clean, as it seems to be working, and this thing still not installed, not working, and this thing, it's making a different kind of noise, but as they don't work at all, doesn't really matter. The important thing is that it's flush and looks better than when it was fallen down. So let's clean this. Shut down. Ta-da! Perfectly clean. Sadly, the top part has a bit of wear on it. It's not in the best of conditions, but yeah, still usable. Luckily, the plastic is some kind of gray underneath, so the scratches don't appear that bad. Okay. Power it on. If you are wondering what I use to clean computers, this is Pronto, and this kind of towels, they are specially made for furniture, so they don't leave I don't know, lots of marks and fibers and stuff. There are also some of these that actually have something like Pronto already on them, and they are in a bag like wet wipes. So yeah, you can use those or this combination, same result, squeaky clean. So yeah, this thing is 100% running and finished. Windows 10 happily doing its thing. This is off, keys all working, and yeah, that's about it, guys. What can I say more? Everything turned out good in the end. A little bit of a struggle in between, but yeah, all is well when it ends well. So thanks for watching. Like the video, subscribe, ask whatever you need in the comments, and see you again in the next one. Bye.